Hello friends, this is Manoj Paplani. I welcome you all on behalf of the Edupedia world. So guys, this is the last video presentation in which I'll be covering the remaining topics relating to the topic of equity analysis and valuation. So I hope that you guys are enjoying your day to the fullest, and certainly you guys are actually ready for today's presentation. So perfect guys, with that hope and belief, and definitely with that kind of virtual test that yes, you are actually going through your topics time and again, you are regularly revising your topics with recurring revisions in regular intervals of time. So perfect, with that kind of belief, I'll start my presentation with the first topic of the day, and that will be relating to other securities. So guys, by now we have already covered the topics relating to equity analysis and valuation. This is the video presentation which actually going to solely dedicate some of the remaining topics which will be miscellaneous in nature, that will be for the covering sake of just other securities. The first instrument which I'll be covering in this presentation will be convertibles. The second one would be right issue of shares. The third one will be valuation of warrants. What are warrants and how valuation of warrants is being done? The last one, valuation of convertible preference shares. What are convertible preference shares and how about going towards valuing any of the convertible preference shares? So we'll be covering all these four instruments one after the other. I'll start my presentation first of all with convertibles. So let's understand what does convertible actually mean. Convertibles. So guys, convertibles mean in itself something which can be converted. Okay. So, or if a debt security is being converted into each other, let's suppose I provide you some kind of things. Let's suppose I provide you a toffee, okay? And in comparison with that toffee, if tomorrow you get an opportunity to change or switch to chewing gum while providing me that toffee, so that will be a kind of convertible agreement. Simple. You provide me chewing gum, I provide you my toffee. So that's simply the normal kind of convertibles that we usually take into account in our daily respective regular lives. But if I'm talking about convertibles in my presentation, that will be solely dedicated to something with a financial background, the one which is revolving something related to finance. So in my case, the convertible securities are the bonds or preferred stocks that can be exchanged for equity shares under some specific circumstances and terms at the option of the holder. These securities give the investor the option to convert the bond into equity at a fixed conversion price. Unlike the exchange of warrants, the conversion of convertible security does not provide any kind of additional capital to the issuer. So that's the kind of con in that case. However, that does provide you an option to convert your debt security into equity shares as and when you get an opportunity. Conversion ratio will be used in this particular segment, because while converting any of your debt security into equity shares, you need to have that kind of conversion ratio with yourself. So guys, the conversion ratio is basically the number of equity shares for which the convertible security can be exchanged. The conversion value of the convertible security is the market value of the equity shares for which the convertibles can be exchanged. Also, in this case, you guys will be taking care of the conversion premium itself. So conversion premium is basically the difference between a convertible's market price and the higher of its security value or conversion value, that could be in any case. The major reason for issuing the convertibles, you must be thinking about why the companies usually look out for those kind of opportunities and instances where they can issue the convertible securities. Why? So in that case, the major reason for issuing of the convertibles is basically that the interest rates on convertibles are indifferent to the issuing firm's risk level. That is one of the major and the most important aspect as to why they go for issuing the convertibles. Several reasons why firms choose to issue the convertibles include sweating the long-term debt issue to make it more attractive, delayed equity financing, raising temporarily inexpensive funds, and financing corporate mergers. These are some of the other prime reasons as to why companies, big-time honchos, go for convertibles option. So that is why it is being usually considered as a very good option to issue the convertibles rather than going for a fixed time securities, either debt or equity in any case. So guys, usually in such a case, investors are willing to pay a premium over value in order to have that kind of possibility of the capital gains from stock price advances, and that will be coupled with the security of the fixed interest payments associated with any kind of debenture. So in such a case, if you avail the opportunity for having any of the convertibles, so one, you get till a certain moment of time a fixed kind of interest payment because you already have that debenture. And now, whenever you get a good opportunity of converting them into an equity share, now you get an opportunity to convert it so that you can get the benefit of the possibility of the capital gain from the issuing of that stock. So that's the basic two advantages you'll be getting. So for a certain point in time, you will be availing the benefit of getting the interest, and after that, you'll take up the possibility chance of getting the best of the capital gains while going for the option of converting it into a stock price. So that's the major benefit that an investor can get. If a price of the payment associated, like the underlying equity share, goes up, the convertible will be valued as something going as a equity shares. And while if the price of the underlying equity share goes down, the convertible will be valued as a bond and not fall accordingly. So that goes hand in hand with the both kind of benefits for you. If the interest rate rise, the security value will fall, lowering the bond floor on the convertible. On the other hand, if in case the security interest rates fall, the security value will rise, increasing the value of the convertible as a bond. So guys, both the things have to be taken into consideration while going for any of the options for convertible security or not. If in case that was actually all about convertibles, but if in case, I'll give you another kind of scenario to make it more simpler for you to decide whether one should go for convertible or not. If the convertible is never exercised, then the cost of the convertible will be lower than the non-convertible debt. If the convertible is converted, then its cost becomes the interest payment while it was not covered and dividends after as it is. In that particular case, the cost of the convertible depends on the conversion ratio, the equity shares dividends, and the time at which the security is actually converted. In any of the cases, while the cost of the convertible many times is less than the non-convertible debt, the limitation of it imposes on the firm's financing flexibility must also be considered, guys. Thus, the issuance of the convertibles involves a trade-off between the cost and the future financing flexibility. Therein, you have to go about all these things. This was all about the full length detailing relating to convertibles. In my case, I actually wanted to give you proper insights of all the things which is relating to this particular topic. That is why I briefed you about all the scenarios which you can go about taking care of convertibles. This was all the complete understanding. If I'll have to sum it up in such a manner so that you can just recognize and remember the few things for your examination point of view, those will be. I'll have to summarize them up. Convertible securities are the bonds or the preferred stocks that can be exchanged for equity shares at the option of the holder. Number one. Number two, convertible securities give the investor the option to convert the bond into equity at the fixed conversion price. Number three, conversion ratio is the number of shares of equity for which the convertible security can be exchanged. Number four, conversion value. Conversion value of a convertible security is the market value of the equity shares for which the convertible can be exchanged. And the last one, conversion premium. It is the difference between the convertible's market price and conversion value. So guys, these 5 points will be like more than sufficient for you to get 4 on 4 in your examination if in case this question comes up. However, in order to provide you the proper glance and proper complete clarity, I've like briefed you about all the scenarios with which you can decide whether to go for a convertible option or not. So that's your choice, that's your calling. My idea was to make you understand this topic. Next comes in right issue of shares. So guys, what does this right issue of shares actually mean? Let's understand it first. Right issue is basically, if I'll have to like sum it up with a very brief and a very good kind of example. Let's suppose there is a kind of lottery which is going on in a nearby colony. Okay, you wish to go for that particular lottery system once. Okay, you went up to that person and you asked him, "Okay, brother, like for how much price am I going to get the ticket?" He actually goes you with an option, "Okay, 10 rupees, and the lottery price is 100. If in case the lottery comes up in your favor, You say, okay, cool, provide me the kind of ticket. So you get the ticket for rupees 10. Okay. So the next time the lottery comes up, okay, but unfortunately you didn't get any kind of chances, good chances. Another time this lottery again happens, okay, and this person doesn't ask you this time whether you want to buy the ticket or not, whether you want to go about taking another chance or not. So you just went up to him and tell him, bro, last time I picked up the ticket from you, but you didn't ask me this time. Is it fair on your part that you didn't ask me? Even though I already availed your services like once back. So he is definitely going to be like a bit feeling guilty about the same, that yes, he didn't ask you about the same kind of opportunity with which he actually offered you last time. So similar is the case with the companies as well. So if you are a shareholder of a company, just like you, me, and various other persons, you are a shareholder of a company, that's a basic kind of expectation you'll be having with that company, that the next time the company, the same company in which you are already a shareholder, if in case that company goes for another kind of option of providing additional shares, then you'll be the first person with whom the company is going to ask, Mr. X, are you going to avail some other shares as well or not in such a case? So before going into external outside market, you will be the first person with whom the company will actually ask that whether you are going for additional kind of securities with the same company or not. So this kind of thinking and this kind of issue is basically called the right issue of shares, wherein the company in which you are an existing shareholder provides you an opportunity to avail the benefit of having some of the additional shares along with the ones which you are already holding. This particular thing is basically known as the right issue of shares. So that was a kind of story which I just narrated to you, and that was in the form of that exemplifying knowledgeable base. But if I have to like present you something with the examination point of view, that will be simply that a right issue of common stock to the existing shareholders is basically a kind of privileged subscription, where each shareholder is given the option to buy some specified number of shares at a subscription price. That subscription price is the price that existing shareholders will have to pay for that particular stock. The subscription price is usually lower than the current market price. I mean, you are already a shareholder. How can you expect yourself to be paying the same amount as to what an external person will be the first time to join the company will be paying? In any case, you will be saying, no, bro, I'll have to go with the on option, wherein you, if you are actually providing the external market to go for an IPO for rupees 10, let's suppose, kindly provide me the same security at rupees 8. I'm your existing shareholder, yeah. Cool. Perfect. So in that case, you'll have to go about the same. The subscription price is the price at which the existing shareholders have to pay for the stock. That will be usually lower than the current market price. Right offerings is usually issued with the standby underwriting. An underwriter agrees to buy the unsubscribed portion of the issue. Losses usually may arise to the existing shareholder value in terms of percentage of ownership, which will arise when the firm sells the shares to the general public. And the same can be avoided with right issue offering that you'll be availing as a existing shareholder. Next, loss can happen in terms of market value as well. The market price per share will go down. Book value will go for an accounting kind of dilution as well. However, since you are going to avail the benefit of right issue, the same is not going to impact you in a very big manner. So that's how it actually works. Okay, so guys, that was all about right issue of shares. Now let's summarize it in the best possible manner. And that will be, a right issue of the common stock to existing shareholders is basically a privileged subscription where each shareholder is given the option to buy a specified number of shares at the subscription price. The subscription price is the price that existing shareholders have to pay for the stock. Losses may arise to existing shareholders' value in terms of percentage of ownership and market value. The same can be avoided if in case you go for the option of availing the benefit of right issue of shares. Now, if in case I want to go for a valuation of that particular right, then what will be the value of that particular right? So I can simply say that any kind of investor usually tries to find out whether it's fruitful to subscribe to the right or renounce it. Renouncing basically will mean that if you are actually getting the opportunity of going for the option of picking up the right issue of the shares and somehow you are not having the money in your hand, or somehow you don't wish to avail that, will simply provide that same opportunity to some other person at a particular price. Let's say the company is going to provide you the same security for rupees 8. You will renounce it at a price of rupees 9. However, the same will be provided to the general public at rupees 10. So herein, you will be renouncing that particular right at a commission of rupees 1, let's say, wherein you will be providing the benefit to that person of rupees 1, that is 10 minus 9, rupees 1, and you will be getting of rupees 1, that is 9 minus 8. So renouncing will be basically providing the same security right to some other person in consideration of something or maybe nothing, if that's your family member or something else. So that will be a renouncing. So an investor usually tries to find out whether it's fruitful to subscribe to the rights or renounce it. He's actually a bit more concerned with as to what would be the price of the shares after the right offering and what is or will be the value of the right after being offered. So that's in we'd go about the same. If you want to go for getting the valuation for it, I'll simply provide you a kind of thing that will be this. The value of the right alone will be the right price equivalent to NP0 plus SR whole divided by N plus R, wherein N means the existing number of shares that a person is having, P0 is the market price minus cum rights, SR basically means the rights price, R is the number of rights offered, and N plus R will be the existing number of shares plus the number of right offered. So with the help of this, you can simply find about the price of the share after the right issue, which is expected to be. So that's how you can derive it in that manner. Next, we'll come in as value of the right. Okay, so this is basically guys called as X right price. It is the price at which will be quoted after the right shares are issued or are allowed to trade along with the original shares. In case of valuation of the right, that will be P0 minus SR whole divided by N plus R. That's the exact same thing which has been like provided in the above concept formula. This is the value an investor will get by subscribing to the right shares. This is generally a positive value. The numerator indicates the overall benefit that an investor gets by subscribing to the right. When divided by his total holding, that is inclusive of the right, he would get the value of the rights per share. And that's how this particular value of the right will be obtained. And the last one will come as right of the rights alone, value of the rights alone. So any kind of theoretical value for the rights alone will be computed by X right price minus rights subscription price whole divided by the number of rights offered. This formula, this concept is basically will be helpful for you to measure the benefit an investor gets per right share. And that's how it is being done. And I'm sure that you guys have actually got a kind of like 75 to 80% of the clarity will relating to this particular valuation concept. However, you did got an idea as to what a right issue of the share is. I have actually went in to get some kind of formula for you guys as an example. So let's understand that example in order to get the perfect kind of clarity with this particular segment. So guys, assume that there is Mr. X who has 1000 shares quoted at rupees 100. The company announces right in the ratio of 1:2 at the rate of rupees 40. Then in such a case, the X right price would be 2 into 100, that is the number of right that you'll be getting, into the price 0, that was rupees 100, plus the rate at which the right is going to offer in as 40, into the number of right shares that you'll be getting, that is 1, whole divided by 2 plus 1. The shares that you are already holding in your hand plus the one which you will be getting in right. So that X right price will be rupees 80. Whereas in case of valuation of the right, you can simply go about 100 minus 40 into 1 whole divided by 2 plus 1. That will be rupees 20. But when it comes to valuation of the right alone, that will be X right price minus rights subscription price whole divided by the number of rights offered. That will be 80 minus 40 whole divided by 1. That is 2 minus 1. So number of rights offered in this case was 1. So that will amount to rupees 40 in that case. So guys, this is the brief example in order to provide you the complete understanding as to how to go about calculation of right issue of shares. So guys, I hope you got the complete clarity with this particular other security as well. Now let's move to our next security, and that will be warrants. While talking to you something relating to warrant, I simply means a share warrant. Okay, so guys, a share warrant is basically a kind of option which is issued by the company to buy a stated number of shares of the stock in a specified price. Warrants are basically generally distributed with debt and maybe like preferred stock as well to induce the investors to buy those securities at a very lower cost. A detachable warrant is the one that can be detached and traded separately from the underlying security. In most of the cases, guys, warrants are usually detachable only. Warrants are issued for their major following advantages. You must be thinking as to why a company will go about going for an option of a share warrant rather than going for issue directly the shares. So the main major few parameters as to why the company is in the advantageous position, and even the investors who are going to wish to avail the facility of opting for share warrants will actually get the benefit. So the number one will come in as that the share warrants are attached to debt issues. Thus, they act as the sweeteners to increase the marketability of those issues. Second, the warrants provide additional cash inflow when they are actually exercised. Convertible securities do not provide that kind of benefit. So that is again the second benefit. The third one comes in as the warrants enables the companies to raise cheaper debt in the local market as they are generally attached to the debt issues. The fourth one will be the warrants delay loss of control in the company as equities are issued later on exercise. Another, that is one of the major benefits. Fifth one would be that the warrants are favored at times when raising the money internationally gets tougher. And the last one would be the hybrid. This is particularly a hybrid instrument that allows the investors to separate their embedded equity option from the bond and trade off separately in the. That's the basic benefit that you'll be getting once the warrants are actually issued. So guys, that was all about major understanding for the warrants. Let's actually go about like summarizing the same. So a warrant is basically an option by a company to buy a stated number of shares at a specified price. A detachable warrant is the one that can be detached and traded separately from the underlying security. Most warrants are often detachable. In a simple sense, if I'll have to like sum and say, warrants are the securities that give the holder the right but not the obligation to buy a certain number of securities at a certain price before a certain time. Warrants are not the same as call options or stock purchase rights. So get that clear, guys. They are absolutely not the same as call options or stock purchase rights. They are absolutely a different kind of different, altogether different form of instruments. Warrants usually have a very longer shelf life as compared to the regular options. The prices at which a warrant holder can purchase the underlying securities is basically called as the exercise price or strike price. And if in case the price of the stock is above the exercise price of the warrant must have what is known as the minimum value. So convertible security is basically a kind of debenture or a preferred stock that can be converted into a common stock at the owner's discretion. Whereas in case of warrant, it is similar to a long-term right in that it is merely an option to purchase some common stock at a stated price. That's the major difference between the two. When a convertible is exercised, it is exchanged directly for common stock. However, in case of warrant, both money as well as the warrant can be exchanged for the common stock. The minimum price of the warrant will be equal to zero until the price of the stock rises above the bond's exercise price. After that, the warrant's minimum price takes on the positive values. The degree to which it is going to change or it is going to rise with the increase in the common stock price will entirely depend upon the exercise ratio. In addition, investors are willing to pay a premium for warrants because only a small loss is possible. And in that, the price, warrant price is basically going to be lower, less than that of the common stock, and it has large return possibilities. That's the basic benefit behind the same. Several factors that are going to actually affect the size of the warrant premium, guys, will include the stock price, exercise price ratio. As the stock of the price increases, the exercise price climbs, the warrant premium basically will fall, and the leverage ability of the warrant will decline. The time left to warrant expiration date, that will also be a factor, primary factor, which is going to affect the size of the warrant premium. As the expiration date approaches, the size of the warrant premium shrinks. Another one, the kind of consideration will be the investor's expectation concerning the capital gains potential of the stock. It's pretty obvious, guys. If in case the investors feel that favorably about the stock, definitely the warrant premium is going to be a very large one. Next one would be the degree of the price volatility on the underlying common stock. So the more volatile the common stock is, the higher will be the warranty premium. So these are actually the all kind of parameters which with which one can go about deciding what are the factors which are going to affect the size of the warrant premium. So guys, that was all relating to the topic of warrant. That was a bit of all the kind of knowledge which I could have like provided to you. Exhaustive knowledge altogether. I'm sure you'll get the best kind of benefit out of receiving the same. I know most of that particular thing is not actually like useful for you for the examination point of view. These 6 points will be like 8 points, will be like more than sufficient for you. But definitely go for listening to my audios time and again, even if once you become a chartered accountant, because that kind of knowledge will be helpful for you once you qualify and you start out your career into the finance domain, finance kind of background. That will be surely helpful for you guys as well. Now let's move to our next topic, and that will be advantages of warrants. I've like briefed you about relating to the advantages of warrant in my last slide. I'll just reiterate you to the same thing in summarized form. Warrants increase the marketability of various issues. Warrants provide additional cash inflow when exercised. Warrants enables the companies to raise cheaper debt in local market. Warrants delay loss of control in the company. Warrants are favored at times when raising money internationally gets tougher. And warrants, being the hybrid instrument, allows the investors to separate the embedded equity option from the bond and trade it off separately. So guys, these are the basic six advantage of warrant. You can go about like revising all these major 6 points. That will be like more than sufficient while answering your 4 marks question in your examination, if in case that comes up. Next slide would be relating to, again, the factors affecting the size of warrant premium. I just discussed with you in my last to last presentation, wherein I told you about all those factors which are actually going to affect the size of the warrant premium. So the first one was the stock price or the exercise price ratio. As the ratio of the stock price to the stock equity price climbs, the warrant premium will fall because the leverage ability of the warrant actually declines. Next thing comes is as time left for the warrant expiration date. So it's pretty normal, pretty obvious. As the expiration of the date approaches, the size of the warrant premium will shrink. That will decline. Next comes in as investors' expectation with capital gain potential of the stock. Obviously, if a company is providing you some kind of good potential and investors are actually feeling that it's favorable about that particular stock, then surely the warranty premium is going to be larger. Next in comes in as degree of the price volatility on the underlying common stock. So the more volatile the common stock is, the higher will be the warranty premium. I am just getting an example relating to one of the major securities which was once available in like 2009, and that was relating to HDFC Limited. HDFC Limited once issued warrants in, I guess, mid 2009, which were priced at rupees like 50 55 rupees, along with low coupon non convertible debentures, which gave the holders the option to buy HDFC shares at rupees 600 or 700 something. That was the issue price within those 3 years. And in August 2012, in that particular case, the effective price of the warrant holder works out to be 675. Why? Because 600 was the price, plus for that they had to like avail and go for the option of buying that particular warrant at a price of rupees 75. So eventually that will work out to be as 675 for them. So if tomorrow in 2012 the amount of share would have been like 1000, for the investors, it would have been like 675 rather than the 1000, because they got an opportunity to purchase, procure the same at just rupees 675. So that was all relating to the topic of warrants, guys. I discussed with you what are warrants, how to go about taking care of warrants while going for any kind of financial decision of opting or not opting for the same. What are the basic advantages that you'll be getting if you wish to go for warrants? And finally, what are those kind of factors that you should consider while going for any kind of warranty premium? So all those factors which affect the size of the warranty premium, that is also being covered over here. So perfect, guys. With this, I'll just move on to our last topic, and that will be convertible preference shares. So guys, this is the one of the most common topic which we have like been reading and understanding since our CPT examination, or even if I'll say 11th or 12th class as well. So convertible preference shares is the one which is being like discussed very briefly over there. I'll be discussing it with at a like holistic kind of level so that you get the proper clarity with this particular topic as well. So guys, preference shares. Preferred stock is basically a kind of element for the shareholder equity that has the characteristics of both equity and debt. A preferred shareholder basically carries all the kind of additional rights above and beyond those conferred by the common stock, that is by the common public shares. Preferred shareholders may have an advantage over common stock shareholders, while in dilution, dissolution, bankruptcy, liquidation, for instance, in many other cases. Preferred shares also generally have a dividend requirement, which makes them appear similar to debt. The dividend structure usually has the rights attached to it, wherein such as whether dividends are cumulative or whether the shares participate in the enterprise earnings. The dividend rate may or may not be fixed or may be tied to some of the type of index that controls the movement of the rate either up or down. Since the preference shares usually like pay you a constant kind of dividend over its lifetime, the value of the share of the preferred stock can be simply derived by a concept, and that will be dividend divided by the required rate of return. That will provide you with the valuation of that preferred shares. This process of determining the value of the preferred stock is not entirely different from that of a common stock, except that the risk is assessed based on the individual characteristics of preferred shares and their impact on the income or cash flow. And that's how it is being done. So guys, preference shares is basically a very good kind of a thing that provides you the best kind of benefits for both the things, debt as well as equity. Like similar to debt, in case of debt, you get a fixed kind of interest. In case of preferred shareholders, you get the best kind of benefit for fixed cumulative dividend. Whereas you also enjoy some of the benefits that usually the common equity shareholder get. So that's the best thing with which preference shareholders can be happy about. They get the best benefit of debt, they get the best benefit of equity as well. So primarily, like when comparing the characteristics of preference shares to the characteristic of similar securities, we usually look up to like major things. Okay, so what will that be? So there are some of the major characteristics that has to be taken care of. An important characteristic of the preference share is its dividend. Based on whether the dividends accrue, if they are not paid on time, decides when they are cumulative or when they are non-cumulative preference shares. If the preference shareholders basically like provide you the right to participate in the earnings or value over above the above stated price decided by the preference shareholders are participating or versus the kind of non-participating. So this is the major basic benefit that you get as comparison to the equity shareholders. In case there is some other characteristic as well, that another characteristic would be that generally it entail a distribution over equity shareholder while going for liquidation. So if the preference shareholders have a fixed term and if they can be bought back by the company at a specified rate, time and interval, decides whether they are redeemable or irredeemable. At times, preference shares come with the voting rights as well. So that's another kind of benefit that you'll be getting. At some other times, this facility of put options are granted, wherein the preferred shareholders are going to take up the benefit of going for the company repurchase the shares for a fixed price. Also, guys, at some point of time, preference shareholders are converted from common stock or into some of the other stock or debt instrument, which is usually known by the convertible preference shares, and in such a case, remember, each specific characteristics usually affect the value of the advantage or disadvantage which is associated with it. So that's how it actually works. Guys, that was all relating to the topic of convertible preference shares. Let's summarize it in the best possible manner. Preferred stock is an element of shareholder equity that has the characteristics of both equity as well as debt. Since the preference shareholders generally pay a constant dividend over its lifetime, the value of the preferred share is equal to dividend divided by the required rate of return. Its characteristics that I was talking about. So the first one comes in as dividend. They get the dividend all throughout their lifetime, whether cumulative or non-cumulative. That may depend on the specific terms of the agreement. Next comes in as distribution right during liquidation. So they are the ones which are actually given the preference over equity shareholders while going towards any kind of liquidation. Conversion into equity shares, that is another kind of benefit. So you get a chance to get yourself converted into equity shareholders rather than staying along for the whole life as preference shareholders. So again, this kind of conversion benefit is also like provided to convertible preference shareholders. Convertible preference shareholders is a very good option for those companies who are actually willing to raise capital on the better terms than they could with equity financing, especially if in case they have very poor share prices or poor credit quality. So that's the best option you can go for. Why? Because the persons who are actually going to invest in your company can be sure of one thing, that you will be providing them the regular kind of dividend. So that is why they are pretty much like thinking about investing into your company. Why? Because you are actually providing them the chance to go for convertible preference shares rather than providing them the direct equity shareholding financing. So that's how it actually works. That was all relating to the topic of convertible preference shares. I hope you guys got the entire clarity as to how to go about the same. And I'll be concluding my video with the last topic of the day, and that will be relating to its valuation. So valuation of a convertible preference shares. So guys, issuing a convertible is basically preferred in such a way because the company who is going to raise any kind of capital will be on the better terms that could go with traditional equity financing. I've just discussed with you. So how to go about valuing any kind of company for its convertible preference shares? So there are some of the conversion values, conversion premium, which we have like already discussed in my one of the presentation relating to bond markets. That will be exactly on the same line for convertible bonds as to valuation for convertible preference share is concerned. That both the things are will be on same track. So I won't be wasting your time while providing the same kind of stuff over here as well. I'll be providing you simply the link of my video wherein you can directly go and go about like reading all those things and understanding the topic, wherein I'll be providing you a brief kind of enlightening note relating to conversion value, conversion premium, security value, straight value, conversion premium as well. So that will be more than sufficient for you in case you get provide the best kind of understanding for that case. So conversion process in this case will be done in a very simple and a very clear manner. So first of all, the conversion value of the preferred shares would be found out. Next, the straight value is to be found. Then the maximum of the above is used to compare with the market price of the convertible preference shares. And finally, those preferred stock will be the element based on the shareholder equity that has the characteristic of both equity and debt. Conversion of the preference shares is done similarly like the one which we covered in bond valuation using conversion ratio, conversion value, straight value, and conversion premium. So here's the link for that video. You can simply go for it. Okay, I'll be providing, we'll be like actually providing you the link in YouTube comment boxes as well, wherein you can directly go for this video and you'll get the entire clarity with the particular these four segments: conversion ratio, conversion value, straight value, and conversion premium. These are the four basic parameters that will be like immensely used for going for any of the valuation of convertible preference shares. So perfect guys, with this I have like already provided you all the topics and all the enlightenment with relating to the equity analysis and valuation. This was the last miscellaneous topic which was pending to be covered with this. In my next forthcoming video, we'll be discussing about all those questions which have been already asked in CA Final examination. Therein, you'll get the proper clarity as to how questions from this particular topics are usually asked in CA final examination. So this particular topic won't be covered in many of the books. However, these will be the questions which will be like marking all the conceptual clarity with different, altogether different aspects for CA final examinations. Therein you'll get the proper financial kind of background and you'll be like asked to think about as to how to go about solving your questions. That will be the best part of this particular segment. So I'll be covering all those questions in my forthcoming 2 or 3 videos. Till then, stay tuned. I'll be covering and concluding my video with a dose of motivation, and that will be, it is very important to know who you are, to make any kind of decisions, and to show who you are. This quote was being mentioned by Malala Yousafzai. Malala Yousafzai is that brave girl who did fought against all those Talibanis. Talibanis are basically the kind of terrorist group which actually don't encourage any kind of literacy for women. They are actually like oppressing them all the time with this particular thing that they don't need to study, they don't need to get educated, they don't need to get literate in any manner. Malala Yousafzai was that kind of brave soul which actually fought against all those Talibanis to prove the world that yes, women can learn things, women can make things actually happen in the best kind of possible manner. So it is very important for you to know who you are, first of all. Believe me guys, if this particular first line is being sorted in your life now, you can definitely go for anything in your life. You can kill it, simply go for. And you'll have to understand this very good thing. So it's absolutely important for you to know who you are, what's your purpose in your life. For all those persons who haven't got their purpose in their respective lives still yet, the only purpose would be to find that purpose, to make all those decisions which are actually going to make each and everyone who is surrounded by you or with whom you are surrounded by will make them happy, will make you happy. So to make all those decisions, you'll have to know who you are, and you'll have to then show that what you can do. Then only things will happen for the best, and then only things are actually going to happen in their respective places. That was all guys. Thank you on behalf of the Edupedia world. Keep interacting via questions, queries in the YouTube comment boxes. Stay connected. That will help us in understanding your needs way better. Love you all. God bless you. Take care. See you in the next presentation. Bye.